Right. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you very much for joining us. My name is Andrew Main Wilson. I'm the chair of the steering committee of Prime and also the chief executive of AMBA. So we're going to very much run to time today, even though we started a few minutes late. So don't worry, you'll get away as per the time of the programme. I think most of you are pretty familiar with Prime because many of you from the Central Eastern European chapter. But Prime, this is our 10th anniversary, so founded 10 years ago to promote and champion the principles of responsible management education across all schools and ideally reaching students and indeed where we can alumni, to champion what I genuinely believe is probably the most important and valuable contribution the world of business education can make to society, which is creating more responsible managers and creating greater sustainability for our planet. So I will be asking questions of our panel and encouraging questions from the audience, whilst my fellow co-host, Yaroslav Pavlov, will be introducing all our speakers. And he is the Distance Learning Director at RANEPA. Over to you.
Okay, thank you. I'm Director of Distance Learning at IBS. This is Institute of Business Studies of RANEPA. And also I'm a member of Steering Committee of Central and Eastern European Chapter of Prime. I want just give a few introduction to our topic, because we want to address not only this idea of corporate social responsibility and teaching corporate social responsibility, but we want to ask if management and if companies really need these socially responsible managers, especially in Eastern European and Russian context, because we have a bit different cultural and ethical, I'd say ethical background. We have a bit different values in the basis of our understanding of business and of management. So there are a lot of controversial issues about teaching this corporate social responsibility and business ethics in a traditional way, how it is done in Western European countries. So, and most of all other speakers I will introduce from my place, but to start, the first our speaker is Dušan Kučera, who is a tutor of International School of Business and Management, University of Economics of Prague. So Dušan will provide us with this philosophical background. Yeah, you are welcome, Dušan.
Thank you very much. Good afternoon. I think the first question is why we are speaking about social responsibility regarding economics. I have visited today morning the macroeconomic analysis of the Russia Federation, and we have seen the challenges. What is true is first that we are starting to analyze the social situation based on economic analysis. I think it is based on a neoliberal philosophy that, maybe on the Marxist philosophy, that the basis is economic. Economic basis are the production relations and instruments. And the law, the sense, the culture, the art is superstructure. So far I see also in our country, in Czech Republic, our presidents are students of Marxism, and the whole privatization process, the whole economic development is based on this frame of thinking. But going back to the original of spirit of capitalism, we have to say something different. Capitalism was based, according Max Weber, on a special spirit of capitalism. It means it is value-oriented thinking, and therefore came to our discussion also the topic of corporate social responsibility. So some people say it's maybe naive, but we are speaking about the shared profit immediately. We know that the capitalism itself is sensible, has a special meaning, and has a potential to be developed. But immediately, if you are speaking about the development of our transformational economies and post-communist societies, we have to see what was the original root and fundament of capitalism. And it was based on a special values. So the first value is the sense of our life, sense of our work, the meaning of our entrepreneurship. Also in our legal system is sometimes said the goal of entrepreneurship is the profit. But today we are speaking about the different definition. The meaning of entrepreneurship is to solve the human problems, to solve the problems of the society. So we cannot live as economic autists, say that the most important is only the money. The money is a secondary influence and consequence of our activity. The second point is remembering that oikonomia is a Greek word, means stewardship. Oikos is a house, nomos is a law. So oikonomia is from the very beginning, from the Aristotle and New Testament also, as a stewardship of house, how to administrate the house. This is the sense and the goal of our activity. So we are facing the neoliberal philosophical approach in economics and are discussing what would be, what are the consequences of neoliberalism that when we are concentrated only on the profit. It means we have now to see the consequences in social environment. We are also responsible not for only economic development, we are also responsible for social development. It means what I am teaching, that economics is a social science. Social science means it is philosophical science, because we are looking in economic activities, what is the sense, what is the value of our work. The second dimension of our responsibility is, after economy, social stability, social sustainability. The third responsibility is environment. Maybe we are profitable, but maybe we do not have any fresh air and water and so on and so on. So the environment is very important. The next and the last responsibility is the future generations. So if you see, I would maybe a little bit postpone and change the social corporate responsibility to the sustainable corporate responsibility. So it means we are responsible also for the future generation. The future generations, after the definition, should not be neglected because of our activity today. So this is the long-term oriented responsibility of economy. So this is the first starting point of our thinking on and of our discussion. You know, corporate social responsibility, for example, in my country, is sometimes a marketing tool. It's maybe sometimes moralism, it's maybe attempt to work in the legal frame, but it's not enough. If we have philosophical reasons, if we have clear fundaments and roots of our thinking, we know why we are working and why we are active economically. So it means we have philosophical task here to make clear if it is enough to be rational, able to make calculation, speculations. So we are speaking about limits of rationalism. If it is enough to have a philosophical concept of empirism, of our experiences, maybe statistical methods. Statistics is saying us something about the past, but not about the future. So we are speaking about limits of rationalism, limits of empirism, and limits of romanticism. Enjoying the life, working yesterday through the Moscow, so it is hedonism, how to enjoy the life, and the sense of economics is how to support our quality of life. But going back, value orientation is trans-rational, trans-empirical, trans-romantical. It's future-oriented, long-term-oriented, value-based. So we have to go back to the sense of oikonomia, what it means. We should be stewards, not robbers. We can rob sometimes, but somebody has to work again some years and to prepare for the robbers the new package. But our task is to tell the students also, and now I am speaking about this task of schools, business school, universities. We have to explain to students what it means, what is the value, what are the roots, what are the fundamentals, and they should understand the meaning, they should acknowledge the ethical dilemmas, and they should be able to get any proper orientation and maybe their own position to be able to make any decision making. So I think I see in this frame the needs of explanation, of understanding, and to be equipped for a special decision making and for special position in real business. And as a teacher for business ethics in master programs and in MBA programs, I can say that our experience, our research with managers is confirming our philosophy that after some first year they are a little bit rich, they have already car and house, now they are thinking also about the meaning, about the future for the children and for the society. So I think this is our experience. I can prove it also on the research and on the special experience with the students. I would recommend it, and I am also open to discuss about this approach. Thank you very much.
Dušan, thank you a lot. This is a very nice philosophical introduction that I believe really guide us to the proper approach to this ethical business, ethical and corporate social responsibility issues. And I suggest that next we move to more practical issue, to the presentation of current research. Actually, Julia, you can probably present from
there.
Yeah, but they, okay. Okay, so Julia Bulatova, who is a lecturer and of Reseba, Riga, Latvia. Okay, please, Julia.
This is, yeah, okay. Good afternoon, honorary audience. Глубоко уважаемая аудитория, здравствуйте. Очень большая честь.
Hello. Thank you very much. I'm very glad for this invitation to address such a distinguished audience. I'd like to present to you a practical-oriented research, which is in line with the arguments that have been announced, stated before.
Fine with the previous discussion also. This will not be very strategic and holistic presentation about the goals of education, so, but this will be really a very concrete study which helps me to build the argument. So the impact of leadership ethics on organizational innovativeness. As we also heard before, organizational innovativeness is, of course, a must for 21st century organizations. So what is the really impact of leadership and how the schools should react? I am a strong believer that school can go together with practice and is not opposite some kind of camps, yeah? But really good research, good studies, and good education is in the core and the fundament of good practice. And it was also mentioned before, if we make a parallel between medicine students, those who really study hard, and business students, why do we allow business students somehow to skip fundamental understandings? So the whole overall aim, of course, of the research is to extend theoretical model of relationship, and the focus is here on relationship. If Dušan was working works more in his presentation was more in economic terms, macroeconomic, this will be from internal, from in organizational perspective. Latvia is a country of transition, or we also know this is dynamic society, and we went through the period of brute capitalism. We can also call it really this way, 90s and 2000. It was another context of a reality we went through. It was not so middle class developed yet, very high segregation of society and very strong competition, very strong win-lose approach. It was still hard to speak about some sustainable values in this period. In 2008, we experienced also big bubble of banking crisis, which also crashed upon our us citizens, and people went to Ireland, people went to England and somewhere else to start to work, etc. But still, we do develop, we have hopes. By these times, we started to develop really a lot of interesting programs. And among them, of course, is Prime also, where our school is hosting Prime for 2 years, so I'm proud of saying that. Among these programs, there are also business practices. First, business practices speaking about sustainability, so they came from Scandinavia to Latvian market, and also now some American companies, and also Russian business has a good, important impact. So it might sound as a paradox, but it is so. So why to speak in about I don't want to lose time of audience with in this study particularly, I used the model by Wang and Ahmed. They distinguish between product, market, process, behavior, and strategy innovativeness. And why leadership? Of course, leadership as those leaders, or leadership as a process, of course, is a basis for how the values are spread in the organization. For leadership model, I used LMX leader member exchange. So this is a model of relationship, really, which is developed by Grain and Ubien in 1995. The model was really a little bit changed, but the essence of this model is the whole focus is on the relationship quality between the leader and his/her subordinates. Do they trust this leader? Can they use a leader as an example, as a role model? Can they really believe that leader will not use against a worker some power and so on? And so, starting from this model, I wanted to see if there is relationship. And so it was moderated also by trust, organizational trust. It follows from some also previous studies by Fukuyama and other authors who say that yes, trust has a mediating role very often if you speak about good organizational outcomes, such as innovativeness, for example, in this case. So the model looked like this. What was interesting is that we used a quantitative and qualitative approach. So it was interviews with workers, subordinators, and also leaders, and also quantitatively, it was 385 altogether questionnaires collected. The correlation was found to be high, and especially using regression analysis, it was really resulting in a conclusion that leader-member exchange and this trust, which is between leader and subordinate, has a strong impact on how employees evaluate their organization and how they feel their organization is doing, is performing well or not. And if there was a relationship of high trust, high collaboration, high good quality relationship, it really resulted in high marks on innovativeness business model, perception of subordinates. Yes, these are main conclusions, and we can say that this is still a work in progress. I'm really interested in this topic, and further now is connected with psychopathic leadership, how is in connection with those leaders who are maybe not as ethical, do they have really high trust, not high trust, etc. It would be necessary to study more in longitudinal also way. Thank you very much for your attention. Yes, maybe later.
Okay, Julia, thank you. Colleagues, we would have all of our questions at the end. And now I want to give the floor to Monsieur Joël Bouzou, President of World Olympians Association, President and founder of Foundation Peace and Sports, advisor of Prince Albert II of Monaco, and world champion and bronze medal winner of Olympic Games in modern pentathlon. So please, Monsieur Bouzou.
Thank you. First of all, it's a great pleasure and honor to be with you here all, and I'll try to to bring my contribution. I completely agree with which was said before, and I will not repeat it. I will try to show also how sport can have an impact on CSR. I don't know if I am a philosopher. I don't know if I am a romantic, as you said before. But what I know is that I think consumers are better when society is stable. It's better for the production, and anything which could contribute to the stability of society should be pushed forward. Peace is not the absence of war, and a lot of people have forgotten that. Betty Williams' Nobel Peace Prize said that. Peace is a result of dialogue, of integration of differences, and of diversity in societies which are today very interconnected, interdependent, in the frame of globalization. And this should be taken into account. And I think that we could also look at CSR from that direction. There is a growing demand in consumers today to look at companies not only at delivering finished products and services, but also contributing to the social stability of society. And I think there is a growing field of play for companies, so that it's not only a philosophical attitude, but I think it's in their interest to be better accepted by general public and consumers. Now, why to speak about sport in that frame? Why would sport be a good space for CSR? Sport is an international activity. It is universal, it is global. It is one rule in the whole world. You practice sport in the same way in Uganda, in Russia, in France, in Monaco, in South Africa. The board of an international federation is composed of people from all genders, all races, all religions, all ethnic groups. So sport has this capacity to not only be neutral, but has the credibility of neutrality. And more than equality, because equality does not exist, sport has an incredible potential to bring equity. And equity, I think, is fundamental in the world of competition. So, especially in the economic competition. So, sport can be a very good activity run by companies in the frame of their corporate social responsibility activities to foster that. It is above social, ethnic, religion differences. With sport, we can activate corporate social responsibility programs in youth development, in gender equality, in health, for example, nutrition and exercise. If you share that within a company, if you run programs like that and you share that between leaders and employed people, I guess it brings more cohesion inside the company. It has an impact on the public, on the consumers, and I guess it would make the companies much more accepted on the territory where it exercises its activities. Sport is also not expensive. I have seen on the side of the Tanganyika Lake, sponsored by companies dealing with water. I have seen volleyball competitions made with two wooden sticks and fishing nets. You push the boats, you create a field of play on the sand, you take the fishing nets from the boats, you put them between two sticks, and you set up a volleyball competition. And when you do that, you bring different ethnic groups together. When they are together, they accept their differences. When they accept their differences, I guess they are also contributing to the stability of society, and they are maybe better workers and better consumers. So I would like just to finish this by saying that, and especially because we speak about former East countries, as you said in the past, which where there is not this kind of culture, I don't think so, frankly, but I would say there are incredible heroes in these countries which are athletes. And retired athletes are role models. They have an influence on the public, they have an influence on the youth. If companies willing to work in the frame of corporate social responsibility would employ such people, they would have at the same time the role models and the people able to become fantastic vehicles for their programs. So I would be really available to go further on that and elaborate more in the frame of the World Olympians Association, of which I am the president, which gathers 100,000 Olympians from 148 countries, and peace and sport, where we have developed activities ourselves, like Sport Simple Solutions, I was naming one before. But we have also collaborations with the University of Peace in Costa Rica, the International University of Monaco, and we have a high-level representative from the university here. And so I will be at your disposal, and again, I'm very happy and proud to be part of this forum. Thank you.
Thank you a lot. This is a very inspiring presentation, because we also see in our own example that sports is very good to promote very different issues, because, for example, in RANEPA, in IBS RANEPA, we have a kind of association of students called Most Mobile Students, who also try to promote this idea of equality for sports. They had this wheelchair rugby matches, and we have seen how important this issues in integration of people with some limitations, health limitations. So thank you for this, and I hope this is not the last of your speech in RANEPA, and we hope we'll see you again here. And so I'll give a floor to the other representative of Monaco, Monsieur Jean-Philippe Muller, General Director of International University of Monaco, please.
Yes. Good morning, everybody, and thank you for welcoming me here in this Gaidar forum. So, as you can see, Monaco is not a very big state, but it's very famous, well-known, and we are very very dedicated to be present everywhere in a lot of events to represent our country, because I think we are the well-represented nationalities around this table. Monaco is a fantastic and very dynamic state for that. I'm happy to be here to speak about corporate social responsibility, because I have to deal with this question, like the dean of a business school, for a long time. When I started my career in business school in France, 2002, I remember we decided to give like a motto to the school, a business school, giving meanings to management. So it was a question at this time. And after that, step by step, we continue to develop this concept. And when I arrived to Monaco to be the dean of the school, first of all, I arrived in a state where corporate social responsibility and sustainable development is very important. And second, the business school was already involved in corporate social responsibility. So it's an important question for the point of view of business school, because if we want to answer this question, does business require social responsibility? If the response is no, okay, it's down. But if it is yes, we need to train future leaders to this concept if you want the future to be socially responsible. So my conviction is the response is yes, but I will explain why. Just before to explain you how I can answer this question, maybe I would like to give you some insight of what is the business school today, because it's important to understand the context if we want to understand how we manage this. So it's a business school that is a small size business school, and it's an important consideration for corporate social responsibility. With 600 students approximately, 22 full-time faculty, a lot of alumni across the world, we are well recognized, we are in the Principality of Monaco, we are accredited across the world. We have different program in different area. We are dedicated to specific expertise that are strength in Monaco, luxury management, finance, international management. We've got program from the bachelor to the doctorate. In all the program, we are running corporate responsibility, and I will explain. Another, we are well recognized across different accreditation, and if you are familiar with those accreditation, you have to understand to be involved in corporate social responsibility for business school, it's part of standard they have to reach to be internationally accredited. So it's part of the question. We are in Monaco, and for corporate social responsibility, it's important because, you know, Monaco is a small state, it's 2 square kilometers. And I used to say to the student, Monaco is your campus. And Monaco is very dedicated to sustainable development because our prince is very dedicated to that. Monaco is very dedicated to corporate social responsibility, diversity, and so. So it's important because we are inside a context very dedicated to corporate social responsibility. I am brief because I want to go to the question, but I would like to show you how Russia is important in our school, because the third nationalities of students in Monaco in the business school, after French and Italian, that are the neighbor of the state, are Russian students. We got a lot, as you can see on the slide. We got, that's the third nationalities when we have intake every year. And we have a lot of alumni coming from Russia. Yesterday, I had a meeting with them. We are more than 100 alumni from Russia, so it's important we are very close to this country. So now I go to the point and to the question. The university and corporate social responsibility. First of all, I have to say we are part of the prime. We are signatory of this fantastic activity, organization, and so. So we do our report every 2 years. We are following the 6 principles in education. I just show you because it's important and it's very clear. A business school has to run education, courses, training, and so, taking care of corporate social responsibility. And it is inside our mission statement. You have our mission statement on the slide. And at the very beginning, the first sentence of our mission statement is we want to educate responsible leader. And another sentence in our mission statement is we want to encourage and develop corporate social responsibility and sustainable development. So it's a key concept, it's a key value for us, and we integrate this in all the teaching, in all the courses. It is the same for our vision statement. One important part, it's in red, is we want to be a significant actor in the promotion of corporate social responsibility, especially in our area of expertise, luxury, finance, financial services, and so. So it's the earth of our vision, the vision of the school. And as I said before, it's inside our state, inside the Monaco principality, ethical principles, sustainable development, diversity, openness. It are very important values for our prince, and is very dedicated inside Monaco, but with his representation across the world to those concepts. And because a business school has to be aligned with the territory, it's a way to be strong, it's important for us to share this. So, does the business require a socially responsible leader? My personal answer to that is yes, because it's a belief. I think the best way to be sure a system profit to everybody is to encourage this business to be managed by a socially responsible leader, because they will take care the business benefit to whole part of the society, young, old people, leader, other, and so. But in business, belief is not enough, I know that. So it's important maybe to give more pragmatic answer to this question. And I have at least 3 for that are more practical and pragmatic. First of all, it's because I'm sure, in the context of a very complex globalization, it's no longer possible to have efficient system to control the business, because organizations are complex, they have unit everywhere in the world, so to control the business, to control the people is not easy. It's more easy to have people trained to ethical behavior. Like that, they will act on a daily manner in the good way, respecting the rules and so. So it's very pragmatic, very efficient answer. Remember some crises like the subprime, like Société Générale in France, we know well that, Lehman Brothers, not ethical conduct. and the reporting and the control system was not able to manage this. So it's the first part for me for the answer. Very quickly, the second issue is more marketing, because now consumers are very well informed of everything with social network. Competition is very strong. So marketing of product is not enough today, you know that. We have to brand, to give value to brand, to sell product. And we are in a system where we go through product marketing to brand and values, okay? And if not socially responsible, a business does not work in a lot of contexts, because consumers act like if they are voting for things. And if they do not believe in those in a business because it's not socially responsible, they do not buy, okay? And young generation now more and more are very dedicated to CSR, a lot of concept inside. So it's a sort of new system where the votation of consumer is important, sort of marketocracy now. And you have to be socially responsible if you want to sell product in a lot of country in the world, okay? So it's a very pragmatic way to develop business. I have a third answer to this question, and it's to reverse the question. Is the question, does the business require socially responsible leader, or does leader require socially responsible business? And it's an important question for a business school, because we want to attract the talentous, the best talentous students. And if they are requiring a socially responsible business, we need to teach corporate social responsibility in our business school. And if firms want to attract the very skilled people and they believe in CSR, they have to integrate their CSR in their value. And I know it was the case, maybe you remember in Europe during the period from 2000-2010, a lot of firms decided to develop ethical charter, values around CSR. I'm not sure they were very dedicated to those values at the beginning, but it was very important to attract the most talented people from the best business school in Europe, because young people, young generation, as you know, are very dedicated to that. So it's a very pragmatic way to attract the best. So I think that's free answer to this question. We can discuss about that, but more than a belief, it's a real pragmatic way to do corporate social responsibility. When it's pragmatic, is it ethic? We can discuss about that, but it's like that. And to finish, I just want to give you some example how we deal in a business school to encourage and support ethical behavior. We are in a context of a very cross-cultural business school, more than 70 different nationalities inside, because we do not have a domestic market. And at the heart of CSR, there is the problem of mutual understanding across the culture and across the people. And mixing students together, I think it's an important way to develop ethical conduct, the respect of diversity and of each other. We do a lot of things. We include CSR inside courses. I suppress specific courses dedicated to CSR, because it's not an exotic topic, a part of the rest. CSR, ethic, and so, have to be taught in each courses. Okay, it's important for me. And we try to promote and value student socially responsible project and to support research through the faculty dedicated to those topics. So now it's not only a small subject for a business school like IOM, it's at the heart of the project and the pedagogical vision. So if you have questions on that, I can answer more than this. Thank you very much for your attention.
Yeah, okay, thank you a lot. And next we give floor to Danica, president of Bled School of Management and president of CEEMAN. So,
Thank you very much. So I would like to say, as one of the co-founders of Prime, we were very proud, and we were in fact fighting to have this role and to make this Prime. And I remember I had very difficult times then, because for 2 years this was not announced, you know, that Prime is existing, because Harvard Business School didn't sign that. And so I think that we may never give up, and we have to fight for the real and right principles that are important for the society. Because we learned that in a more complex international business world, one cannot be successful without holistic, visionary, and professional management and business leadership, and we need for that socially responsible managers, and we need the schools that are producing that. And I shall just focus on what are we doing in CEEMAN and in our school for that last years. Firstly, we are, if I am talking about more important organization, International Association, CEEMAN, then I have to say that we were in our international quality accreditation. From all the beginning, we are insisting that sustainable development and ethics has to be a required subject, not something to choose, you know, but a required subject. And if you don't have this, you cannot get the accreditation. So that is very, very important. Besides, of course, you know, we are talking about excellence and relevance also, but besides the quality in other fields, we consider that as one of the main criteria of the quality of management education. In order, you know, then you come to that, how to help to management schools that they are really becoming qualified for that. And that's why in IMTA, we were, I think it's 6 or 7 years ago, we were adding, in IMTA is International Management Teachers Academy, we were adding the subject, besides finance and marketing and strategy and leadership, we were adding the subject, sustainable business in society. And we found one of the best teachers in the world to teach this subject for 1 week. Because what we don't have, and that's why I'm so happy that Riseba makes a research, and we are also, and I'm so happy that we have the chapter in the school where, in Latvia, where this is one of the main principles in management education. Because we lack the materials. Our teachers, you know, our teachers, I'm calling you Irina, you see. Our teachers don't have the material to teach. We don't have case studies developed. It looks that Janez Škrabec was calling you, you see.
Yes, yes, yes. So I know that I would be punished by you.
No, it's great. No, it's, I just want to make some atmosphere, you know, to make some fun. So you have to understand it like that. So we were seeing that it's our responsibility to help to develop faculty who are able to teach and help to develop material for this teaching. And so I invite everybody here in this room who have, you know, good case study, you know, good case, that we are making a case study because we are looking for that. And then I would like to say, and of course, another materials also. And then, so it is just to tell you that if you have also the faculty who would like to be better faculty in teaching business in society, in June every year, we have a two-week program in Bled School of Management, in CEEMAN, but this is located in Bled School of Management, where we have first week, you know, general methodology of teaching, and the second week is how to teach, you know, besides other subjects that I mentioned already, how to teach business in society. And it's from Bentley Management School, from Bentley University, professor who is coming, Tony Bono, who is coming to teach that. Then, as I mentioned, we are, if I go now to the school, I have to say that we are, as a believer in our school, in this vision, we are and working on that. We became one of the 30 prime champions in the world. And what I see, and we have in 2 weeks now, when it's an EFMD conference in Ljubljana at Faculty of Economics, we have in Bled the meeting of the prime champions, because many are coming to this conference, so it's good to combine that. And we are there sharing the best practices and showing, you know, to each other how we can become a better champion and how we can get more champions, because we are the only one in Eastern Central Europe, and I am proud of that on one side. But on the other one, as a president of CEEMAN, I cannot be proud to be one, to have one champion in Central and Eastern Europe. So try to become champion. And try to, you know, in the former presentation, I was talking about business school also as a social platform. I think that we succeeded to do that in Slovenia, to be a social platform in this field, because we unified work of all these associations, I mean unified, on such a way that we do many things together with Institute Equilib, with United Nations Global Compact, etc., and with this champion, you know, championship. So we should, as I said, and then Coca-Cola Chair for Sustainable Development, etc., we can be much stronger and much better if we do the things together. And and I would also like to say that business schools, I would like to make at the end once more the plea that the business schools and educators should be really better prepared for these important tasks. And if in CEEMAN we can do anything in this field, please let us know. We shall do it, you know, from sharing the materials, from anything possible, what we collected together, we shall be ready to share with all of you. Thank you very much.
Thank you. I also hope that more Russian business schools will be more active in PRIME, because, for example, at the when we founded this Central and Eastern European chapter of PRIME, where was just really a few Russian business schools. So I hope that other colleagues will join us and will work together with us on this promotion of these principles.
Can I just add one thing? You know, what you said, I appreciate very much. But, you know, by receiving and welcoming the first Chinese management school in CEEMAN, and by creating a global MBA, you know, Silk Road MBA, my first condition was to put in the program, in the MBA, ethics and sustainable development. So we can have broader impact than only in Europe. We can have it everywhere in the world if we are really aware of that and having a courage to do that. Thank you. Thank you.
Yes,
First off, could you let everyone know how many Russian schools are there currently in the PRIME network?
I cannot say for sure the number in the PRIME network, because last year we found that some Russian schools that are members of PRIME still are not signatures of Central and Eastern European chapter. So we now try to find out all the Russian schools who participate in PRIME and bring them to Central and Eastern European chapter, because we actually now have some representatives who will join this chapter, I hope, nearly today.
Irina will tell us at the end of the session.
Yeah, we will ask Irina. So, and for this issue that Professor Purg told us about teaching CSR and introduction of CSR courses, I want just to announce that tomorrow we will have a small workshop, which is out of the main program of Gaidar Forum, because it is out of the format of Gaidar Forum. This is a small workshop where our participants of PRIME CEA chapter will share their experience in teaching corporate social responsibility and business ethics in the Central and Eastern European context, and this different context of post-socialist countries. So it will be 10 o'clock tomorrow in this building, auditorium number 269. So if you want to join, you can just address me this question. And now I want to give a floor to a representative of corporate sector who also participate today in our panel. And maybe I'll ask Vadim Kovalev to give his presentation. Vadim Kovalev is the first deputy executive director of Russian Managers Association, and also a member of the presidium of Nasdobr. This is Russian national accreditation of business education programs. So, Vadim, please.
Здравствуйте, уважаемые коллеги.
Good afternoon,
colleagues. I'm very glad to participate, and so representative of forum. I am very grateful to RANEPA for raising this issue and putting it on the agenda of the Gaidar Forum. For us, it's very important that this topic is still relevant. As you know, this year we're going to celebrate the so-called Old New Year. We have this tradition, and this brings me to the thought that our traditions set our habits, our behavioral models, our habits, speaking about corporate and social responsibility. Certainly, we cannot say that we are content with what we are seeing in Russia. Unfortunately, the peak of fashion for CSR in Russia is behind. We were hit by the crisis and the recession that followed in its footsteps, and managers have found themselves in a bit of a fix. They've got to show to the shareholders, to the top management, how important it is to have a corporate social responsibility. And in this vein, in accordance with the corporate activity concept, we are in the middle of the road. Very often, corporate social responsibility in Russia is perceived quite ambiguously. There are different views on it. Should we look at the top management, then, regrettably, we'll have to state that in Russia, as of now, there are around 70 to 80 companies that are pioneering. They've got their own sustainable development programs that are incorporated into their business model. They implement and promote these models, engaging with the government institutions, with local communities and authorities. They adhere to a comprehensive approach. In the past, they mostly used to do that based on strategic programs, but in Russia, it is of particular interest to engage with a wide array of persons concerned, entities concerned. Let me show you who these top managers are that we've got to involve in promoting the CSR concept. We draft some sort of a rating, working together with Commissat newspaper, designating top 1,000 managers. And based on our research, we have come to a conclusion. Usually, the Russian top manager is a man, a male. He is around 40 years. He lives in Moscow. He is into sports. He certainly has higher education, mostly from a Russian higher education institution. 90% of top managers have got education in Russia. 27% of them have got an MBA. In this context, it is quite natural to ask the question what the major risks are for the activities of corporations, of companies. Have a look at what the response of our top managers is. They say that the greatest risk they see, the main danger, is the instability, the volatility of financial market, the state regulation, as well as personnel-related risks, environmental-related risks, just 3%, local communities, just 1%. And this is the reason why CSR is in the periphery of public administration and managerial concepts. Yes, sometimes we hear CSR mentioned in certain platforms. Gaidar Forum is just a happy exemption to this rule. Yesterday, we even had a session dedicated to that. So there are no risks, as you can see. Even if companies do not observe the CSR, nothing is going to happen to them. Nothing bad, I mean. Up to now, corporate social responsibility and business participation and societies life are perceived ambiguously by our society. At our request, the Social Opinion Foundation conducts polls asking Russians very simple questions. They ask the population, if companies are engaged in social activities, does it mean they want publicity, or do they really want to address social issues? And up to now, unfortunately, even though there are some positive dynamics, almost half of the Russian population, almost half, are not sure that the business is serious in addressing social matters. They do not have trust. Russians will understand what I'm saying. There is a great lack of trust in Russia. We all are suspicious of one another, and we are all suspicious of our football team and our road police. And amid this lack of trust, it's very hard to create any programs. Apart from that, we've got another study, another poll. We were asking businesses how they were building their strategy. Apart from companies involved in exploration, most companies plan for the coming 3 years, so they do not have a long-term perspective. This means that we cannot talk about sustainable development or corporate social responsibility. Now, getting back to the profile of a manager in the context of corporate social responsibility, I cannot but mention another Russia-specific problem. Probably I'm wrong, maybe in other countries it's also relevant. Very often CSR depends on the position the proprietor takes or the leader takes. Let's take a proprietor of a plant. He or she might used to have some hobby, and regardless of what the others think, the employees have to support this hobby, even though this can be completely unrelated to the business. For 2 years, for now, we've been working together with RBC newspaper, creating the top 50 managers rating in the context of social responsibility, corporate social responsibility. You can see the graph right in front of you. The question is, those people who are responsible for CSR within the company, what are their functions? The blue part, 24 out of all the rest, they are responsible for corporate social responsibility. They are also responsible for PR, corporate management, strategic management, GR, and HR. These are the cream of the cream of the management. All the rest is the middle management, which cannot take any key decisions. Mostly they deal with other matters. Unfortunately, not all companies have a specially designated manager responsible for CSR. If we look at the different industries, I'd like to take particular note of FMCG sector, and the sector that ranks second is mining and metallurgy, such important industries as agriculture, media, timber processing. They are underrepresented. Yes, they do something with regard to CSR, but they're not doing nearly enough. Even though one would imagine that agriculture should be very concerned about CSR. And getting back to that man with a perambulator, the profile of a top manager, we ask the question about the personal experience, and you'll see that only 4.5% never participate in charities. There were different choices. And the questionnaire, the most important answer is that companies just give money to charities. Unfortunately, so far, they do not participate personally. And let me dwell a little bit before I conclude about a personal experience of our own. For our association, the corporate volunteership is of great importance. We are confident that this type of model can engage top management, middle management, and lower management, and the employees in this process, creating some shared value. And in this sense, please pay attention to our statistics, to the studies conducted by us. Mostly in Russia, young specialists are actively participating in this kind of activities. And we are in complete agreement. Volunteership and corporate volunteership in Russia, these are matters promoted mostly by women. That is our peculiarity, so to speak. What motivates people to engage in this kind of programs? Mostly altruism. They want to help people. Positive emotions are also a factor. Have a look. Career is cited as a motivator only by 3% of the people. Unfortunately, people do not see any career opportunities in volunteership, even though we understand that when you do this kind of work, you establish horizontal and vertical ties in the company, you foster new ties. Unfortunately, people in Russia lose sight of this aspect. As you can see, business schools are an important factor in this process. The Russian Economic School, New Economic School, has a very active program to engage both alumni, graduates, professors, and students in this type of programs. They've got a charity committee. They've got a special week dedicated to engaging the public. They've got some marathons for charities. So this school has a platform. They take this opportunity to incorporate it into the communication strategy of the school as a whole. And I think they're quite efficient in that regard. And now, a grain of optimism to wrap up. We have a look at the statistics, the poll conducted by Headhunter. The students were asked about their experience of participating in volunteer projects. 40% of students say that they do participate in this kind of work. I think this figure is quite inspiring. If in several years these people come work for a company, they're going to be a good category for promoting corporate social responsibility within the companies they're going to work for. At the same time, I agree totally that business schools and universities have to stimulate, have to promote the participation of students and professors in these programs. Right now, only 51% of universities do not stimulate such programs. Only 49% of universities do. I think this motivation has to be promoted. And now, in conclusion, if you have a look at the global trends and the CSR context, I'd like to take note of the last trend cited to us by our colleague from Forbes. Unique stories, storytelling, all that helps popularize this concept, citing concrete examples of successful businessmen. We have to show people that their leadership, their success are based on their engagement in social work. How successful they are thanks to CSR. I think that's of great importance because in Russia, unfortunately, we cannot sight out of the blue. More than three or four examples of top managers or owners of companies that personally participate in social work. So, colleagues, I am optimistic, albeit cautiously. I believe that our joint programs are of great help. The very fact that CSR is discussed at leading world schools such as RANEPA is an inspiring fact, and we, for one, the Managers Association, whose half of whom are graduates of Bland School, well, I'm confident that we will be able to achieve great results together. Thank you.
Simon, you prepared the floor very really perfectly to the next speakers. We have these representatives of companies who really care about these issues and who can provide us with this storytelling. And maybe I'll ask first Mr. Škrabec, Janez Škrabec, Chief Executive Officer of Riko from Slovenia, and the owner of company Riko, to make a small story about this corporate social responsibility in your company.
Да, здравствуйте. Я буду говорить по-русски.
Hello, I'm going to speak Russian. Vadim spoke Russian. I saw no one using headphones. Everyone understands Russian as far as I see. There is yet another reason. Regrettably, the English language very soon will no longer be the official language of the European community. I do hope that Russian is going to become one, however, very soon. Vadim, you shared with us some optimism with regards to CSR in Russia. I remember now that I get many invitations to attend different events in Slovenia. But most invitations come to me from some art festivals, invitations to concerts, not just in Ljubljana, but also in Zagreb, in Moscow, in Vienna. And I've got many invitations from Sberbank. There are many exhibitions, many festivals, concerts, performances. And these events are attended by the top management of Sberbank and many other companies, Mr. Graf, Mr. Golovkov, before he became president of Neshikanon Bank. They all attended it. When Mr. Kučera has raised a number of very interesting issues, and I agree with what he said. I'm an entrepreneur, I'm a businessman. And what is the most important thing we pursue? I agree with you, we've got to solve human issues. And I remember a company which is known to all of us, which is very popular. And so far this company is not making any profits, and that's Pesta. And yet we see how much it is worth, how its capitalization is growing. I think it's a very good testimony to the fact that the best entrepreneurs shouldn't think about profits in the first place. This shouldn't be their primary concern. In the past, I was accusing people of romanticism or even proclivity for philosophy, but I became a romantic myself. Warren Buffett, we know him. He is one of the most successful businessmen of the world. He knows how to make money, but he himself says, I'm not a businessman, I'm an artist. So Pierre is also a philosopher, in a sense. and I pride myself on being one as well right now. What should we get from the school, and what should we learn at school? When I was studying at the economic department in Ljubljana, I learned a lot. Right now, I'm one of the members looking after this department. I think this economic department has done a lot. Many schools like that pay great emphasis to culture and art. Let me rephrase what Stefan Hessler said. We can moralize. Yet another quote from Warren Buffett, when he was asked how he accepted new employees and what was the most important thing he took into account, dynamicism or intellect or integrity. His answer was integrity. Integrity, according to him, was the most important quality he sought in his prospective employees. I'm very glad to be here at the Gaidar Forum today. I think it testifies to the great importance attached to social responsibility in the Russian higher education institutions, and I'm glad to be here at this session dedicated to responsive and responsible managers. In a couple of days, I think this is going to be the main dominating theme of the Davos World Economic Forum. As we know, the World Economic Forum in Davos is the most popular now. But I think I've already told you everything I wanted to say here. Maybe I shouldn't go to Davos after all. So, as I said, as you can see, the World Economic Forum report says that the capitalism of today might be running some risks. There are two great inequalities: the divide between different classes is growing, and this is the great problem which we are faced with, according to the authors of the World Economic Forum report. The gap between the lower class and the top class who have all the money is too great, and it gives birth to populism in the US and in Europe. Right now, 95% of the US population think that they live much worse than a decade ago. Moreover, they think that it's not going to get any better. It's only going to get worse. So we have to revisit the system we live in. We have to become responsive and responsible.
Don't want that will be happened. То что случилось сто лет.
Otherwise, we are going to see something which happened 100 years ago in St. Petersburg once again. Thank you very much.
Nothing, as that will happen again. Okay, and I want to give floor to the last speaker, last but not the least, as always, one of our Russian corporate social responsibility champions in management, one of the people who are in this ranking about which Vadim told before, Alexander Arkhipov, who is the director of corporate philanthropy and international communications of JTI Russia, and also guest lecturer of IBS RANEPA. So, Alexander, please.
Thank you so much, Yaroslav, once again. I think I will speak in Russian since I don't see anybody wearing the headset in the audience. Здравствуйте, дорогие друзья, очень приятно.
Good afternoon, friends. I'm very glad that we've met all of us here at the Gaidar Forum to talk about corporate social responsibility. We have got a special panel discussion dedicated to this theme, so let me remind you how usually these events go. This, I think, reflects how relevant this theme is in the professional community. Vadim said that the fashion for CSR has passed, but I've got a different view at this topic. 2 years ago, maybe, we could have easily imagined a conference organized and dedicated to CSR. But that conference would have been dedicated to discussing whether this is a good thing or not, and the conference would have been dedicated to talking about that. But right now, everyone understands that CSR is required. But unfortunately, there's one vestige of the past, and that is the incomprehension of what corporate social responsibility is. The wider public does not understand what it is. CSR is not just a list of activities in which businesses are engaged. This is not just about charities or volunteership. It has a wider spectrum. I would go as far as to say that CSR is not about activities. It is a mentality. It's a new mindset. It's a philosophy behind the new business model. Very often, we confuse these things, and this is what leads to confusion among people who talk about CSR. CSR, for any company, for any business, is a list of questions the company asks itself. And these questions are always company-specific, depending on the industry, on the geography, on where the business is represented, on the difficulties the company is up against when pursuing its main avenue of activities. That is where all the questions stem from. I'd like to say a couple of words more. I think for quite some time, CSR specialists have been encountering the problem, that is, how to explain to the employees and to the proprietors of the business what CSR stands for. And luckily, I see some positive trends, positive shifts here. Right now, people understand that CSR is not about how to spend money, but how to get money. And this comprehension has come to pass.
What is difficult about the fact that people are not aware what CSR is a profile of a practitioner? Vadim has come up with the results of a study from the Managers Association, and correct me if I'm wrong, Vadim, but it was hard to find 50 people for the top 50 rating. And it's not accidental, I believe. In some of the presentations that were made today, the topic of how the corporate social responsibility is taught at business schools was discussed. And it's hard to find a CSR specialist or a tutor or a professor that would teach that course, because no one knows where do such people come from. There was a diagram presenting those dealing with CSR and other adjacent fields, and it turns out that CSR is not their core activity. They are rather, well, quite often deal with something else, and they may drum up a reputation within this or that company, and as a bonus they were given this job of teaching CSR. Although such specialists, such professionals are sort of futurists for this or that company, because any line of business has a time limit, a horizon, and you want to look behind that horizon to see what is beyond. And the people dealing with CSR should be very broad-minded, and they should have a lot of academic knowledge and expertise to be able to come up with such projections and shape portfolios of social responsibility activities for this or that business. And the last thing I'm going to mention with respect to the personal profile of CSR professionals is that studying CSR as a standalone subject would probably help us as a community. Forgive me for this repetition, but quite often even those who teach CSR don't know what it actually is, so we should go back to the source first. Thank you so much.
I would say that at this point we see situation, then we conceptually understand why business need corporate social responsibility, but we see that quite often business doesn't understand that and doesn't understand even what is corporate social responsibility. And probably now we can turn to questions and to open microphone. So.
Sure. All right. Thank you very much. An excellent range and variety of speeches and speakers. So looking ahead and being positive about what we can do going forward, one thing that we will be doing at Prime this year is releasing a number of video interviews with top CEOs who are doing a very good job leading multinationals to inspire both faculty and students. And some of you may have seen Paul Polman, the chief executive of Unilever, speak yesterday. I conducted an interview with Paul a few months ago, and Unilever are doing some amazing things. But hopefully, when you talk about those very interesting negative views in Russia, which are understandable, hopefully it's some of the multinationals coming in who globally are bringing in higher standards that might breed some more confidence in Russian consumers, such that more local companies then adopt some higher standards as well. But we're going to issue that video with Paul, and there'll be more following. So really opening it to the floor now, some of your questions, but also your views on what you think Prime and our schools here could and should be doing to move us ahead in this area. We've got a roving mic, so we'll bring it across.
Thank you. Sorry. My name is Tatiana Smetanina, PhD in economics, and I have a question. If we talk about social responsibility, I would like to ask you, do you agree that environmental and ecological responsibility is a part of social responsibility? If yes, I have a further question for Russian and foreign colleagues. Do you have in your teaching practice the courses of environmental management tools, multi-level environmental management? I think it's very, very important. If you have, please tell some words about these courses. If no, the further question, do you plan to involve the courses of multi-level environmental management in your business teaching practice, in your business school? Thank you.
So probably as the only representative of Russian business school in this panel, I'll try to answer the second question. Yes, we have a course and courses on corporate social responsibility and sustainability. So and when we talk about sustainability, we also include ecology and ecological issues in this term. So probably if you want to know a bit more, Alexander, as the lecturer of this course, can say a few words about what he's teaching at this course. So can you just...
Okay. I think really that there is a need to present the whole concept of corporate social responsibility to those who are studying business, because as I mentioned in my speech before, there is an understanding that corporate social responsibility is about donating money or contributing to a good cause, which in fact is not exactly the case. Speaking about environmental programs, I think that in terms of corporate social responsibility programs aimed at ecological well-being of the communities, there are some fantastic examples in Russia, which are mainly driven by large organizations working with natural resources. There are some fantastic programs in Sakhalin, to the best of my knowledge, and there are some complicated technologies they equip in order to develop the programs. But I have to apologize, I'm not the forefront expert on ecological sustainability. Speaking about our experience, I would say that yes, ecological well-being is a part of a corporate social responsibilities social responsibility agenda we employ. Since we have production facilities, three of them in Russia, and the well-being of the communities nearby the factories is obviously of an interest to us. The programs of corporate social responsibility aimed at the ecological well-being, in my view, they start from arranging a clean production facility if you are a manufacturer, because that's obviously the most important contribution you might employ, and we are proud to be one of the cleanest production facilities in Russia. Recently, that was certified by a number of external judges and experts, and we believe that this really sets a tone for the conversation. We had a fantastic experience here in Moscow when we were we were promoting the green the so-called green conduct, when we thought that some voluntary standards for production facilities, which factories would voluntarily sign to, would be of a help. It was a revelating experience to talk to some of the businesses when you realized that actually it was just not on the agenda. So in theory, they were interested to do something green, but they did not understand what exactly that means. Green public procurement. I apologize. I think I don't quite understand what that means.
Maybe in Russian.
Environmentally friendly procurement best practice.
Yeah. The question was about green public procurement, зеленые закупки.
Mm-hmm.
If you have this type of courses, and I would like to hear the response of our foreign colleagues, please, sure. If it's possible, please.
Okay. I can share a little bit of...
Julia, just a second. Monsieur Bouzou had some comment on this.
I would like a very short comment. For me, the answer is not only in courses. Which consists in terrorizing actions. The answer is also in promoting the actions, promoting the best practices in order to change the mentalities, to prepare the ground. And I want to give two examples. For example, the IOC legacy program after Olympic Games. This is really a big social responsibility program and concept. the action of EY, Ernst & Young, in favor of women integration is also something which is massive, and all the company is completely involved in that. Dirigents, workers, but it has a big impact on the ground and society. So you can learn how to teach. I mean, you can teach that to managers, but you have also to promote the best practices so that you prepare the public, you prepare everybody, and you change the mentalities for the future.
Can I have this? Okay.
Riko is an engineering company. So we are providing technical solutions. We are building in energy sector, in ecology sector, in logistics. We are delivering tool machineries, etc., etc. In 2007, when we just started the crisis, you know, I had this opportunity to talk to Paul Krugman, the very well-known Nobel Prize laureate from economy. And we were talking about the whole crisis just started, you know, and we were talking about how could we go out of the crisis. And you know, according to many economical theories, you go out of the crisis when the new technology comes, and this is this driving force, then through this we go out. And I asked him, okay, but do you see any new technology, any new paradigm in our life that should be this trigger? And he said, yes, of course, green technologies. And since then, you know, Riko, this was for me big business opportunity, you know. And since then, you know, in Slovenia, at that time became the part of EU, and we get many cohesion funds, and those cohesion funds went especially into the renewable energy and in water cleaning, then management with the garbage, etc., etc., and 50% of those projects were done by Riko. So if you want to be on the good track, if you want that your school would be perspective, go into this field. Yes, this is good business case, you know, business model.
Okay, colleagues, last remark on this, and we have next question.
So maybe this is the question, what it means to be responsible. So for what we are responsible, toward whom we are responsible. So we have so-called triple responsibility concept. We are responsible for economic figures, we are responsible for social, for regions, for environment. I was working 10 years in Skoda Auto, Volkswagen company, and now I am very sad about this Volkswagen scandal. So you know, we can be very healthy in financial sector, but we have a problem in a special environmental area. So it means we are living only in one planet. We all are living only in one world, and we are responsible for everything. So therefore, global market needs global ethos. This is the idea from Professor Hans Küng, and therefore we are speaking about the philosophical holistic concept. We have very much case studies about ecological consequences of business, and especially industry, chemical, food industry. So thank you very much for the question.
Okay, thank you, Sue. Please.
Yes, good afternoon. I guess I will build up on what was discussed, because I'm representing Moscow School of Management, Skolkovo. And in 2014, in partnership with Unilever, we actually established the Sustainable Business Lab. And if speaking about the programs, then this April we had the first open enrollment program for sustainability leaders in Russia and from emerging markets. And it was based both on international practice and on our own research. And if I would talk about cases, then that's what we are also doing. Because together with Unilever, we've just finished the case on Tula plant of Unilever that experienced complete transformation in terms of sustainability strategies, and we've actually submitted this case for EFMD competition this year. So I guess in Russia we could say that we are also moving into the right direction and working at the full-scale implementation of sustainable strategies for emerging markets. So if some expertise is needed, welcome to Skolkovo. Open enrollment program next April is also in the calendar. Thank you.
Okay, very good, thank you.
The question there.
Добрый день, коллеги.
Afternoon, colleagues. Sustainable Development Generation Organization, regional organization. First of all, my appreciation to the organizers, for as it's the first platform that I attend, and I believe that we have had a reset or reboot, because previously when we came to such platforms and forums of corporate social responsibility, we were aware that we could actually do nothing. We have just talked and that's it, and we're at the point of zero, and still now I can see that we have had the rebooting, and we now have different type of discourse. We started talking about ideology and common shared values and shaping these values. It's so good, it's so amazing. And from the regional perspective, I must say that we've been lacking proper education. Like, we have a federal university, one of 12 federal universities, and there is a special course on CSR. Probably the level is unsatisfactory anyway. Why not have some webinars, some other types of activity? In this case, we would understand that, well, the public sentiment is fine-tuned to accept this CSR concept, because, you know, now we have more people attending our round tables, and everybody starts saying that in 3 to 5 years we will arrive at the universal acceptance of this concept. But anyway, I believe that now we should start working hard to have these programs launched. Last year we tried to promote, organize a contest on sustainable development with a high-profile magazine, and we had only two applications, Nestle and one regional bank, because people were not ready and their awareness was low. Regional companies were not ready to share their information, and public authorities are silent on that. And my stance is that we should turn to future generations, and the current generation, I believe, should start probing into youths and into public sentiment. We cannot reboot the people with set and fixed mentality and mindset, but why not start shaping the future sentiments and moods? And my question to everybody, well, there may be some practical case studies or something, and in this country we do have a lot of case studies, but no one knows about them, and people and companies are afraid to share them because they fear tax inspectors coming to them or any other inspectors, and they fear saying that they have this or that segment. Or if we invite our regional labor minister to attend and sit on the regional commission, he or she says, okay, but I can't inform the corporates about social responsibility contests, because they would be unwilling to participate at this point of time. And we should have much more people submerged into that issue. And among business newsletters and new magazines, we should have more. And banks also should participate, like the World Bank promotes this topic globally. And I really hope that in the course of time and future and over time, we will have either Sberbank or some other banks that will provide reduced interest rates for socially responsible businesses. That probably should be one of the real effective incentives, because why authorities, it's no use now. I would just give a piece of advice about how to promote this topic in the regions.
you should always act as mass media, like act in the context. Now in Russia, let me inform and advise our speakers, we're having the year of environment this year. 2017 is announced to be the year of environment, and in the context of the Paris Agreement and overall preoccupation with the environment, we should promote this topic because it's on everybody's agenda now. And last December, President Putin read his address to the Federal Assembly that made mention of volunteership, and the Civic Chamber and other relevant bodies have now picked this topic up, and so you can use the context, international and domestic context, and us being a association, a group, we're always open for communication, for cooperation. We have a committee on corporate social responsibility headed by Irina Bartina from Unilever. She's a visionary and futurist in full compliance with Mr. Arkhipov's concept, and we shall be glad to continue and follow up on that. May I add a bit in Russian so that I should respond to a Russian speaker in Russian? You know what? We may begin with, you know, stating and recognizing the fact that the level of education so far is not too high, and we should raise the level of education. Tomorrow there'll be an event in which Vyacheslav Denka will be attending, and he's in charge of different projects, including RICE project, which is social entrepreneurship, and our academia. Our university is represented in many regions via branch offices, outlets, and probably you could get in touch with him and discuss things. May I also ask, my question is whether there is a notion, a concept of corporate social responsibility for state or socially oriented institutions and establishments like museums. I represent a center of modern art, and all our activities are about future. We don't use any printed matter. We are in line with green practices, and we aim at a local community and the children. We attend to kids. Is there a special notion of what is corporate social responsibility for such establishments and institutions as ours? And are there any training courses or programs for me and my colleagues to attend or take, or some abridged version at least? Well, I mean, the sphere of culture. You know what? At our university, we have the public sciences institutions, and they will launch an art management program this year. And once again, we should turn you to Alexander, who will be delivering a course. You know, as regards social responsibility and for non-for-profit organizations such as your Modern Art Center, well, we know that every one of us has a heart, and everyone has social responsibility. You haven't been able to single out your share of social responsibility, which does not mean that you don't do social responsibility. Any governmental or any organization or establishment has a procurement procedure in place, and you should promote fairness and fair-minded approach. I don't think that there are special types of social responsibility as a, you know, for each and every establishment. It's about their sphere of activity and about their responsibility. And your organization is going through a very interesting streak of development. One stage of your development is over, and probably there is another one coming. I can cite an example of a major corporate
that I know. For quite a while, the corporate social responsibility was the responsibility of a number of divisions and units, and there was no entity in charge, and they carried out a big study in 100 countries and million cities to single out 12 questions that are the most relevant as per the employees' opinion, and these made further on the agenda of the corporate social responsibility of that major company. So I believe this is an approach that merits our attention. Another comment, we've been dealing about programs. Programs matter. I hear about fantastic programs and courses, but I know that there are blemishes with them and flaws. If we take macro and micro tools about management, there is a lot of ranting, but very many specific things, specific tools, like come up with 12 or 20 tools of micro and macro environmental management. I wouldn't like to answer this question now because I'm no frontline expert on that. I know that this is your core activity. I agree with you that it's important. But for each and every business, there can be a separate individual targeted set of corporate responsibility measures. For us, it matters that our manufacturing is a clean one, and I'll exchange contacts with you so that our specialist on CSR can get in touch with you. But I fully agree with you and share your view that well, it's quite salient and evident that sometimes people that want to become volunteers want to remove rubbish, clean rubbish and litter. I don't know why. And when it turns out that there may be different environmental concerns at this or that community, and there may be some other measures, these volunteers are perplexed and stunned. And as a vivid example, well, Vadim has said that we're now in a year of environment in this country, but we are not fully aware what the situation about the environment is. It's horrendous. So don't scare us, no, no. But anyway, I'll tell you, well, there was a town, and we wanted to do some charity program there on environment, and we tried to analyze the real needs of that community. And it was found out, quite surprisingly, the following. First, that town had 300,000 people of population, of residents, and the litter was moved to a dump site in a pit, and the authorities wanted that litter to disappear all of a sudden. And one of the problems that were raised by local communities that there are no litter bins on in the streets, and the stakeholders, when questioned, said that litter bins would not last longer than 5 days. Afterwards, they disappeared. With respect to environmental standards,
all these steps, I'd like to say specifically that we as community do not do the simplest things to care for our environment. So I believe we need a step-by-step approach.
For time only for last one question, unfortunately. And I'd like to provide a floor to Irina Sennikova, who is also the chair of CE chapter of PRIME. So please, Irina, can you?
I wanted to ask a question concerning the sponsor CSR, but there is no time. I will not do that. The only thing, just I would really like to maybe emphasize that for business schools, for management school, there is an excellent framework in terms of PRIME. And Prime CEE chapter, which is for Central, and я, может быть, буду говорить по-русски, потому что в первом...
Maybe I should speak Russian because I primarily address the Russian audience. Prime chapter was created in April. Many European schools banded together so far. Not many Russian schools are represented there. We invite you to gather together all these issues that have been raised. We can talk about them based on this platform. What we are lacking, what resources we need to come together. We're going to hold the steering committee session. We are getting ready to celebrate the 10th anniversary of Prime. We want our voice to be heard. We want more weight, more authority, both in Russia at the regional level and at the international level. Only if we are able to band together the business will be able to achieve success.
Very much. I think we're through now. I think the view is we don't have time for one more. I mean, if you wanted to come and ask one specific person, please do. So thank you all to our 8 speakers. Thanks to all of you for coming. It's Prime's 10th year. You're going to see a lot of activity and initiatives from us throughout the year. And you have your meeting tomorrow morning, I believe, Yaroslav.
Yes, I just remind you that tomorrow morning, 10 o'clock, we have a small meeting, small workshop on teaching corporate social responsibility in this building, the room number 269. So you are welcome, everyone. And if you're interested in the teaching CSR, 10 o'clock in the morning. Okay, so thank you for coming to this panel.
Thank you again. Yeah.